I would like to oppose the motion moved by Ms. Cyd Ho and the amendment.
Dr. Priscilla Leung, Mr. President, why did we have the NPCSC decision on the 31st of August? In early 2013, Mr. Benny Tai first suggested the Occupy Central movement and paralyzing the police force. And then in March, Ming Pao Daily quoted me in saying that if Mr. Benny Tai continued with his way, the NPC would become even more conservative and Hong Kong's constitutional scene will remain stagnant for at least 5 to 10 years. At that time, they fetched people to criticize me severely. From March 2013 to the 4th of August or 31st of August 2014, what made the relation between Hong Kong and the NPC enter an ice age is because the pandemocrats went beyond the basic law. They proposed civic nomination, which is not mentioned in the basic law. And then in the joint declaration, nothing was mentioned about universal suffrage. Well, basically only capitalism, stability, prosperity remain unchanged for 50 years, etc. are mentioned. Well, Article 45 of the basic law does mention universal suffrage, but there's no time frame. Universal suffrage is the ultimate aim. Earliest 1997 or even after 2047. After rounds of controversy in 2007, the NPCSE gave us the green light. Earliest by 2017, we can have universal suffrage for the CE election. But still, there's no roadmap for universal suffrage. And now, with this NPCSE decision, which the pandemocrats wanted to overturn, if they can understand the expert opinion of the NPCSC for universal suffrage, they'll tell you the NPCSC has already shown its greater sincerity for launching universal suffrage in Hong Kong. Well, we cannot blame you if you don't understand, but if you understand, then we must put the blame on you. Now, the pandemocrats treat all nutrients from the NPCSC as poison. Same for the NPCSC. No matter what the pandemocrats propose, methods, directions, etc., are considered poison by the NPCSC as well. And the pandemocrats have been misleading their people in judging universal suffrage. I understand how they misled the crowd. Benny Tai at first said that he would like to fetch 10,000 protesters so as to paralyze the 40,000 members of the police force. Ms. Claudia Mo said she never heard about this. That was impossible. That's the lowest class of mistake. Maybe she didn't hear Benny Tai say that. He actually told his crowd. He cheated his crowd. Many of those people silently supported the pandemocrats. Many of them were young people, and then they participated in this very much abhorred Occupy Central movement. This sort of threatening tactic has actually damaged the atmosphere for universal suffrage. In March 2013, when we discussed with the mainland experts, the atmosphere was completely different from that on the 31st of August. The attitude was totally different because you led them into believing that they should distrust pandemocrats. You dug pits and then you jumped into them and then you wanted referendum. Well, you're very pleased with the hundreds of thousands of people who supported the referendum, but then our relation with the CPG entered the Ice Age. There were promises for stability and prosperity, but then you launched a lot of opposing activities, like these pseudo-shopping activities. The nominating committee is a good design, which is conducive to the development of Hong Kong. Many people say that the nominating committee is to safeguard the CPG's interest. From 1984 to 1990, those who supported the nominating committee are from all sectors of the community. They're afraid of socialism. They have professionals. They have politicians at the district level. They'd like to keep capitalism, the low tax regime, as well as the interest of the religious sector and the labor sector. Indeed, there are safeguards in Article 45. The NPCSC has a vetoing power. Members of the public have this one person, one vote right. In fact, that is the best protection for all sectors of the community to keep their interest. We have political and economic strength to balance the interests of all sectors of the community, to handle properly the relationship between Hong Kong and the CPG, to keep a low tax regime and prosperity and stability of Hong Kong. The pandemocrats should be brave enough to admit that their judgment was wrong. They supported the Occupy movement. They should admit that mistake. Those supporting members of the public will understand that they've trusted the wrong people. After so many activities, they are nothing. The world will be regenerated by people who seek in whatever way the method by which people can agree. Mr. James To. Mr. President, recently President Xi Jinping suggested that we should govern the state by way of the law and the constitution. In fact, the NPCSC decision was against the 2004 interpretation as well as the Chinese constitution. It must be withdrawn or amended before we can, in accordance with the basic law, have universal suffrage under the basic law. Now, the August 31st decision had added three aspects to the 2004 interpretation by the NPCSC. In 2004, the NPCSC discussed Annex 1 on the electoral method. In the draft proposal to the NPCSC on the election of the CE, whether the method should be amended and whether the power of amendment should rest with the NPC. In order to have a high degree of autonomy for Hong Kong and to adhere to the basic law, the NPCSC, through the interpretation, decided that starting from 2017, the CE had to submit a report for a decision by the NPCSC if there's to be any amendment. And the amendment method must be proposed by the SARG to the Legislature of Hong Kong with a two-third majority support. The SARG could go to the NPCSC for a decision. So that's manifested in step two of the five-step process. That is, there must be an NPCSC decision. But the power of the NPCSC is manifested in step five. The decision on the 31st of August got three hurdles. First of all, the basis of the 2004 decision was exceeded. In the past, the NPCSC did not lay down any framework. Take, for example, increasing nominating committee members from 800 to 1,200 was not specified in the 2004 NPCSC decision. Secondly, the legislation law of the PRC stipulates the electoral system for the SARG, and is only by way of legislation that the SARG can have its electoral law. Without that, the CPG and the NPCSC have the right to authorize the State Council to promulgate administrative rules and regulations for parts of the issues. But judicial issues and some other issues are exceptions. As for the civic rights of the SARG, that comes under Articles 8 and 9 of the Legislation Act in the form of exemptions. That is for the election method for the CE, even administrative rules and regulations would not suffice. Thirdly, the CE election method should be in accordance with the actual circumstances of Hong Kong and on the basis of a gradual and orderly approach. And given the composition of the nominating committee, a simple majority support is necessary, and the committee should have only 2 to 3 members. 1/8 has now become a half. This is thoroughly against the principles in Article 45 of the Basic Law. The decision on the 31st of August is unconstitutional, and it is not legally binding. And as early as October and November last year, I already wrote articles in the newspapers to comment on this. But then all articles and individuals who speak against the August decision of the NPCSC, like those written by Mr. Liu Hongmeng, were not in the compendium of comments submitted by the CE to the NPCSC. I hope that the CS or the secretary can explain and clarify to us that such views will be submitted to the NPCSC for consideration. Mr. Liu Menghong did ask the SARG to launch open debates on whether or not the August 31st decision of the NPCSC is unconstitutional. For example, on a recent occasion, there were comments about the constitutional or otherwise of the NPCSC decision. In accordance with Article 62 of the Chinese Constitution, the NPC can change or withdraw improper decisions made by the NPCSC. The NPCSC is one of the bodies who can put forward such a proposal. Later, we'll have the CPG meeting. Before that meeting, we should seek a change of the NPCSC decision such that we can reactivate the constitutional reform procedures. Finally, politically, whether the decision can be changed depends on whether or not the CPG is determined to genuinely implement universal suffrage in the 2017 CE election. Or would the central authorities want to maintain the so-called phase of the NPCSC? But for the sake of universal suffrage, nothing is unchangeable. I hope that the CPG will have the courage to make such a change. Thank you.
Mr. Ronnie Tong. President, first of all, I'd like to thank Ms. Cyd Ho for moving today's motion. But then, today is already the second occasion on which we are debating on the constitutional reform package. The last one was moved by me, and if I remember it correctly, some of the amendments were also similar to the motion that is moved by Ms. Cyd Ho today. And on the last occasion, the motion and the amendments were not carried, and therefore the chance of this getting approved today would be next to zero. But then, like Ms. Cyd Ho, it's very important for us to state our stance on the August the 31st decision by the NPCSC. But then many people have viewed this as a chance for us to indicate our stance. But then since August the 31st, the PAN Democrats have signed different joint statements almost on every alternate day, so we would be stating our stance on TV programs. And Mr. Charles Mocker was smiling, and then he made a few remarks the other day on the TV program, and he was criticized round and round by all quarters of the community. Well, I can sympathize with this sentiments, because amongst the PAN Democrats, I was the first to come forward to say this on TV, that we have to veto the August the 31st decision. Why was I the first one? Because I was doing a live TV program, and that's why I was asked for my view, and immediately I came forward to state my stance, and people are thinking that we would be making an about turn. In fact, on the online polls, people were not betting on my stance anymore, because they felt that I was bound to make an about turn. And therefore, people are telling me that I should not be stating my stance today in this motion debate. But then I have to state clearly that when it comes to constitutional reform package, my stance is indeed somewhat different from my allies in the PAN Democratic camp. When I said that we had to veto the August the 31st decision when it was first announced, indeed I was very frustrated. That's why I said so. But then, on second thought, given the fact that we had the veto power in this council, this is the only political force under the constitutional setup that we can do something about it. Why are we not making the best use of it? If we just veto the package, and if we ask for the taking back of the decision, in fact, all we are saying is that we are going to veto it. But then after vetoing it, I do not see what kind of value will this package have. And I do not see how it can carry any weight in terms of our constitutional developments. That's why I was wondering why we are not making any better use of that. That's why, starting from a few months ago, I began to advocate that we should make use of that veto power so that we'll be able to fight for democracy for the people of Hong Kong, which we have been fighting for more than 20 years, so that we can abolish the functional constituency seats. Well, when the media think that this is a hot topic, and then the SAR government and also the pro-establishment camp just jump forward, feeling surprised. Why on earth are you asking for the scrapping of functional constituencies? As if this was the first time that this was ever raised. All right, Hong Kong people have been asking for the scrapping of the FC seats for more than 20 years. The Basic Law has made it clear that all members of this council should be returned by universal suffrage. So it's all members, not half of them. In fact, it's been made very clear that after the election of the chief executive by universal suffrage, we're then going to have this council returned by universal suffrage. All right, let's say that, even assuming that it's genuine universal suffrage for the chief executive, you said that you're going to return the chief executive by universal suffrage. Then after then, why can't we have a council fully elected by universal suffrage? So all we are asking for is to come clean on that. So can you confirm that we're going to scrap all FC seats? But then you're saying that, the FC seats should be there forever. So how can you ask me to pocket it then? Returning this council by universal suffrage, you said no to it, and then for electing the chief executive by universal suffrage, you said no again. And then you are asking me to pocket it first. So how can that be convincing? And if there is mutual trust between us, even if you ask me to pocket it, there might be some value in doing so. But then there is no mutual trust whatsoever. So many PAN Democrats criticize me, saying that I'm making an about turn, and you're paving the way for making an about turn. And why are you so silly? Why do you trust the Communist Party? But sorry, even if you say that I'm naive, but then Hong Kong people have been fighting for the scrapping of FC seats for more than 20 years. So are Hong Kong people also naive? And you say that we should not trust the central authorities and you're being too naive. But then every day we are living in this political environment under the one country, two systems principle. So are we naive? And we trust that the basic law would be protecting our basic rights. Is that also naive? And some people are writing that we should be resisting the Chinese Communist Party. Is that also naive? All right, in politics, there is no question of being naive or otherwise. I think all we are trying to do is to try to make the best out of everything. So in politics, we have to come up with a way of getting out of this quagmire. Even if you think that this is completely groundless, there is no way that this can succeed. Well, we have to find out a way of allowing the PAN Democrats to do something about it. If you say that FC seats will be there forever, then why don't you take it back? Why you should not be asking us to pocket it? And there is no need for you to come to this council because you're indeed insulting the PAN Democrats. You're insulting all the Hong Kong people. And you're insulting those who have been fighting for democracy for more than 20 years. Michael Tian. President, since the reunification, this is the third time that we have triggered the consultation exercise on constitutional reform. This is the most difficult one. First of all, the Occupy Movement trio started this, and they tried to occupy Central. And then after the August 31st decision by the NPCSC, the Federation of Students and also the Scholarism staged this Occupy Movement. And the damage done to Hong Kong is difficult to estimate. Let's not forget about Article 45 of the Basic Law, which says that well, the way the chief executive is to be elected will have to depend on the actual circumstances of Hong Kong so that we can apply the principle of gradual and progressive development or gradual and orderly progress so that we can have universal suffrage for the chief executive election and then have this council elected by full universal suffrage. And the only words that I can remember from the article is the principle of gradual and orderly progress. Well, democracy has been a gradual progress, and in no country can afford to have a quantum jump in terms of democratization. Definitely, the progress has to be gradual. Moreover, under one country, two systems, anything has to have the blessing of the central authorities before we can do it. Well, the opposition camp has the right to disagree with what I say, but then this is a fact that we have to accept. In simple terms, without the green light from the central authorities, it would be difficult for Hong Kong to implement universal suffrage, or else why would we have the decision by the NPCSC in 2007? Well, the PAN Democrats are asking for autonomy rather than independence, but then the central government thinks that Hong Kong people can only have autonomy under the framework imposed by them, and if we try to do anything else, then we are challenging the authority of the central people's government, then it would be tantamount to getting independence. According to my understanding from the residents here in Hong Kong, when I talk to them, in fact, many people do understand this condition and the practical situation, and they can also see the anxieties of the central people's government in Hong Kong. And Hong Kong's opposition camp does not agree with the view of the central people's government. It doesn't mean that the central people's government is going to change their stance because of this. With regard to the NPCSC decision, would it be changed because of Hong Kong people's opposition? Definitely, I don't think that would be the case. So the PAN Democrats should know it deep down in their heart, and they should understand this deep down. With regard to our trust on the central authorities, as a father, when my first daughter was born, and when she was young, she wanted to stay overnight in a friend's place, and then both my wife and I drove her there, and then afterwards we took her back, and then a year later, she wanted to go to Ocean Park, so we drove her there, and then we picked her up back. And then a year or so later, I had to drive her to the MTR station, and then she would take the MTR to wherever she wanted. And then a couple of years later, there was no need for us to do anything. All she needed to do was to tell us where she was going, and then she had the freedom to do so. So you can also say that that's a gradual and orderly progress. That's the mutual trust between parents and kids, and this is mutual. And it's the same with the central authorities. When it comes to communication, for example, the Beijing authorities invited the pan-democrats for a talk. But then what happened then? Some pan-democrats went there to distribute leaflets, and some actually could not be bothered, and they just wanted to have international standards and civil nomination. But then how can we have trust? And when it comes to Hong Kong's political or constitutional development, Mr. President, I've brought with me this chart because I'm an engineer. That's why I like to have charts. All right, 1997, 2002, and then 07, 08, and so on. Well, from 1997 to 2002, if you look at our democratization, all right, 400 becoming 800, and then in 2002, there was a jump. And then in 2007, from 800, it became 1600, but then it was vetoed by the pan-democrats. That's why it was a standstill, and as a result, we put up with it for 10 years. And then in 2012, instead of having 1600, we only had 1200. And now we want to develop it this way to 2017. But then, would it be accepted or acceptable to the Hong Kong people? Well, what I'd like to see is that we would like to see the red line here, so that in 2017. We can have a breakthrough so that there can be a substantial change. And then afterwards, what is going to happen? Well, in 2022, I expect that to continue. If Hong Kong's democratization can develop in this manner, this is what I think Hong Kong people should take pride in. And in terms of our democratization process, that is what Hong Kong should have embarked on. So it's not a very long line without any change in 10 or 8 years. Mrs. Carrie Lam has repeatedly said that with regard to this constitutional reform, she's not optimistic because the pan-democrats are concerned that if they accepted that, then we would be expected to pocket it forever. That's why they are not willing to do so. And some pan-democrats have also made it clear that after vetoing the constitutional package, they would resign to trigger a referendum. But then there is no time for us to resolve this dispute, and I do not understand why they have resorted to this. So apparently this is the wrong timing for something that is also wrong. So I cannot understand it. And probably I'm inexperienced. That's why I cannot understand. And last month, the RTHK and the Hong Kong U conducted an opinion poll. And overall speaking, some 43% supported the passage of the package, and then 32 were against it. So the discrepancy was huge. And recently, some said that in 2022, there can be improvement, and the nominating committee can be increased to 1600. We can also have a subsector for youth, and the candidates can also increase to 3 to 4. I hope that the central authorities can also make some commitments. So in submitting a report to the central authorities, these recommendations should be made. I think that would also help enhance or boost the support from the public, and then the pan-democrats will have to give it a second thought. These are my remarks.
Mr. Felix Zhong. Thank you, Mr. President. Just now, Mr. James To was analyzing whether the NPCSC decision is unconstitutional and illegal. Of course, he is a lawyer and he understands the argument. However, the NPC is the highest authority in CPG, and this is the mechanism set down. So whether it is unconstitutional or illegal, I dare not say. What is sure is that the National People's Congress is the highest organ in the mainland authority. It can make laws, it can amend laws, it can also interpret the basic law. So just now, on the allegation of the lack of an international standard, of course, the NPCSC can interpret the basic law and suggest that there is no international standard. So it's really difficult to have a valid argument. Well, We've started the second round consultation exercise. We haven't had much opportunity in discussing with the PAN Democrats. I understand that there have been breakfast meeting. I wonder if there could be more such meetings so that they can put heads together to have an outcome. Well, just now, Mr. Ronnie Tong says that we should make use of what we have, and I really think that the PAN Democrats should sit down and have a discussion. Whether there is any outcome or not, we don't know. But I often tell Undersecretary that it's quite pointless to consult the Chambers of Commerce or Trade Associations, because they would definitely support you. You should instead go to the enemy side and discuss with them, because if you are willing to discuss with them, perhaps you could get it fixed. And we also see a very threshold, and definitely one of the pandems can become candidates, I believe. Well, on one occasion during a luncheon, I had with Mr. Leung, and well, I won't tell you what occasion it was, but just now Dr. Lam Tai Fai said that we lack political talents in Hong Kong. But Mr. Leung said that no, we do have political talents in Hong Kong. And if somebody with political talent from the PAN Democratic camp could take the lead, and then together with CY Leung and Dr. Ann Chang, they could become see candidates. And if those two are so incompetent, and then the pandems could field such a competent candidate, then even I will vote for you. So there is a chance you could be nominated. Can you say that you have zero chance of being nominated and exit the gate, so to speak? I don't agree. And there is also a paragraph in the consultation document saying that in the event of non-appointment by the central authority, what should happen? What should the mechanism be? That is, there is a chance that the CPG may decide not to appoint or veto that candidate. So I don't think there is just zero chance. However, Mr. Leung said that they do have somebody who is really competent in their camp, then do field the person as candidates and take part in the election. However, as many already said, many asked whether this is the end game or whether this is the destination. But definitely, this is just a mid-stop. As we know, as far as politics are concerned, there is never a destination. Well, I also took part in that dinner gathering with Mr. Hugo Swire, the Minister of Foreign Affairs in UK. And in the hundreds of years of a democratic development, Mr. Swire told me that they still make changes every day. So they have not reached a destination. So is this the end game? Or perhaps after this stop, further revisions could be made to everybody's satisfaction? I believe in the latter. So well, we should always be flexible, as Mr. Tam, Undersecretary, said recently, that the 50% threshold is not up for discussion. Well, I don't even know in future whether Mr. Raymond Tam would continue to be secretary. So perhaps if you pass the proposal, the threshold might be more relaxed than you thought. There are always changes in politics. Maybe in future I would say that the threshold is just too low. So I don't think we should make our final remarks at this stage. And just now, Mr. Abbott Ho challenged the government. He said, well, if you're willing to give this undertaking, I would resign. Well, if so, why doesn't he resign now? He can resign, and then we can hold a referendum, look at the result, and decide then if he's going to resign anyway. So, Mr. President, I don't think it's pragmatic to reactivate the constitutional reform process. Instead, we should put our heads together so as to come to a fruitful outcome. So I don't support the motion or the amendment. Mr. Leung-sing. Mr. President, just now Mr. Felix Chung said that if there is somebody from the pandemic's camp with political talent, then he would vote for him. But what I'm concerned is you may very much want to vote for him, but in the end, you won't really press the button to vote for him because you act according to the mainland's instructions. Just to quote an example, we all understand that our incumbent chief executive, CY Leung, was not really the so-called anointed one, so to speak. It was Henry Tang, and at the final stage, the central authorities gave the instruction to give all the votes to CY Leung instead of Henry Tang, and many act against their own conscience and voted for CY Leung instead. So this is a real example coming from last term. What would happen? Well, you may say very clearly now that you would vote for that candidate, but as you put it, as far as politics are concerned, changes happen every day. We can't really predict what will happen. Well, just now, Dr. Lam Tai Fai talked about his friendship and his acquaintance with Ms. Cyd Ho, and acquaintance with Ms. Cyd Ho, he didn't just want Ms. Cyd Ho to change her mind and support the proposal. He also wanted to play the political card. That is, for the sake of national security, for the sake of safeguarding the high degree of autonomy in Hong Kong and Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong, we must accept this reality, albeit reluctantly. Well, Mr. President, most importantly, this NPCSC August 31st decision, one may wonder, and it is important, whether the NPCSC decision could really safeguard a high degree of autonomy and Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong. In fact, it's clearly written in the basic law that in relation to the election of chief executive by universal suffrage in 2017, if the method is to be changed, there should be a two-third majority support from the NEXCO, followed by the CE's report to the central authorities for approval. So the NPC is the final gatekeeper. It's up to them to give its approval. However, in June 2004, the NPCSC amended and interpreted the annex to the basic law and changed the three-step process into a five-step one. And in a five-step process, the following elements are added. That is to say, the SAR government should report on the selection of chief executive to the NPC. Well, there is no problem with this addition. However, the following says that if in the view of the NPC there is a need to revise the method for selecting the chief executive, the NPC can have the power to confirm the amendment. As other members put it, This is for confirmation, not for making any decision. However, according to the basic law, ultimately it's the NPC that is the final gatekeeper. However, that's not the case in the NPCSC August 31st decision. Now, confirmation has become decision. In terms of the number of candidates to be nominated, which means 2 to 3, to the endorsement from half of the total number of NCs, all sorts of rules are laid down in the decision. It's a wide departure from the term confirmation. That is why, all along, the Central People's Government and the SEL government claims itself to be ruling Hong Kong in strict compliance with the basic law. But the question is, are we really in compliance with the basic law? Obviously not. So, otherwise, why would that be included in the basic law? Well, we should understand that if there is an element of civic nomination, as some in the community puts forward, then we'll be able to really have Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong and a high degree of autonomy. But this is exactly what the central authorities is afraid of. That is why they've closed the door. They will confine the number of candidates in the C election by having a 1,200 strong NC. And then people can be allowed to exercise one person, one vote to choose the candidates so screened. But in the end, we're all doing the biddings of the central authorities. So this is not Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong or high degree of autonomy. So Dr. Lam Tai Fai, we want the NPCSC August 31st decision to be withdrawn, not only to have Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong a high degree of autonomy, but also to safeguard our one country, two systems. It is not about national security. It's not the case that we have to act not in the interest of national security and be subject to external forces, that we can do that.
Ms. Martinell, Mr. President, today's motion is a repeated efforts of the Pan Democrats to reject and challenge the decision of the NPCSC on the 31st of August. Let's don't look at whether the motion is reasonable or not. Starting from the announcement of 31st August decision, they have been asking for that for nearly half a year. They have not seen any success. They have not got the wide support of the community. They still keeps on pursuing. They try every means. They want to lead society to go down this road. Mr. President, I want to take this opportunity and let you see clearly that this direction is really going nowhere. The HKCE and the LegCo can be elected by universal suffrage because it is the result of one country, two systems enshrined in Article 45 of the Basic Law and also 68 of the Basic Law. China is a country. The central government plays a very important constitutional role. The NPC is the highest authority of the country. NPCSC is the standing body of the standing organ of the NPC. Its interpretation has constitutional authority. The NPCSC in 2004 conducted an interpretation of basic law, and in 2007 made decision in respect of Hong Kong's constitutional reform and set out a timetable for universal suffrage in Hong Kong, and i.e. the election of the fifth chief executive of the Hong Kong SL may be implemented by universal suffrage, and afterwards all the eligible members can be elected by universal suffrage. And then, and therefore, we can have today's consultation on the selection of the CE by universal suffrage. The decision of the NPCSC on the 3rd of August last year set out a clear-cut framework for the election of the CE. If you reject the NPCSC's decision, you reject the election of the CE by universal suffrage in 2017. The 31st of August spells out very clearly, a decision spells out very clearly that starting from 2017, the selection of CE of the Hong Kong SAR shall be implemented by the universal suffrage. If the decision of 31st of August could not be implemented, then there will be a very serious question. There will be no change in the future. The decision of the 31st of August is based on Hong Kong's circumstances, is fully taken into account the views of Hong Kong. Unless there are substantial changes in the future, the decision of the 31st of August, if cannot be implemented by in 2017, then it may still be implemented in 2022. A misleading statement that after revoking or rejecting the decision of the NPCSC, the constitutional reform process can be restarted. The starting point will still be the same. Why waste these 5 years? The motion is just harping on the old tune of the pandemocrats. They allege that the decision of the 31st of August enables the nomination committee to screen out the candidates. That is, now, in fact, their proposal wants to make sure that the pandemocrats can have the chance to participate in election. A political system should not be designed for a particular group of people and to ensure that certain people will certainly be nominated. It should be formulated according to long-term interests of society. If today one ignores the constitutional setup, if one ignore other people's view, ask for overturning decision NPCSC and accommodate to the call of the pandemocrats, then in 2022 there will be another group of people making another demand. Will you design another election package so that they can become candidates? Mr. President's recent opinion polls showed that the majority of the citizens hoped that there will be political reform according to 31st of August decision. They want to have one person, one vote electing the CE. They want to see that the political system can move forward. The thing one should do is to work on this constitutional basis. Form a consensus. The motion and amendment go against public opinion. The so-called true universal suffrage is or genuine universal suffrage is just a red herring, and it can only waste the time of Hong Kong. I cannot support them. Thank you, Mr. Yiu-chung.
Today. 全國人大常委會
Mr. President, the NPCSC made a decision 5 months ago. The CPG, the SALG, the relevant officials had already stated the bottom line of the CPG. Mr. Cyd Ho seek to revoke the decision of the NPCSC and restart the constitutional process, political reform process. Then I have a question. Either she doesn't understand the basic law, or she doesn't understand the role of the NPCSC, or she hasn't understood the spirit of the 31st August decision. The NPCSC plays a very important role in the constitutional setup. According to the basic law, the NPCSC has the power to reject the laws in Hong Kong and also introduce national law into Hong Kong under Annex 3. he can promulgate emergency situation in Hong Kong and also keep record of the chief judicial officers. It also has the power to amend the motions and laws in Hong Kong. The NPCSC has power to interpret the constitution and implement the law, interpret the law, interpret the constitution, and even the Supreme People's Court is under its power. The NPCSC, NPC has overriding power. The constitution cannot be amended, and the basic law cannot be amended lightly. What are the CE? The election of CE is an important issue. And the implementation of basic law with regard to the important decision, the decision by the NPC is very meaningful. It is very solemn. The opposition attempted to force the NPCSC to change its decision. That is impossible. Some say that the 31st August decision took away the room for implementing true universal suffrage. That is wrong. Implementing universal suffrage to the CE is a historical development. It is an important change in our political system. The decision on the 31st of August is to set out a basic framework for the political development of Hong Kong. It has to be reasonable, lawful, and sympathetic. It also has to be careful. There shouldn't be any mistakes. There shouldn't be any mistakes. If the reform is kept within the bounds of the basic law, according to the current consultation content, there is a big step forward. If one disregard political reality, breach the basic law, breach the decision of 31st of August, wants to achieve everything at one go, that will only lead to disaster. Mr. President, over the past year or so, the SALG did a lot of consultation work. In the first round of consultation, the trio, together with officials, attended 226 consultation meetings and local activities. They met with different parties of this council, different members of this council from different parties, exchanged views directly. They went into the community, listened to the views of the public and local people. During the consultation period, more than 120,000 submissions were received from different parties, different individuals, and they were all published. During the occupation movement, the SALG exercised the highest level of tolerance and sympathy and exercised restraint. And the government, SALG, tried to be kind to them and arrange for a meeting with the Federation of Students. They tried to reduce adverse impacts on citizens. They hoped that the political reform package should be passed to improve the situation so that the central government can have confidence that we are able to implement political reform after 2017. It's not to block any possibility for true universal suffrage. The SALG works within the political reality of Hong Kong to find the way forward with the greatest possibility. The opposition attempted to use foreign forces, foreign influence, and public opinion to force the SALG and the CPG to give in. That backfired. That raised the CPG's concern towards the risk of political reform, and they are alerted to the influence of foreign powers, and they may even reduce the room for political reform. In fact, the opposition is sacrificing the well-being of 7 million people at the end of the day. That will bring doom to Hong Kong. I hope the opposition will reflect hard on what they have done, and they should not resist. They should not do anything that is not meaningful, and they should have the gallantry and generosity and stick out the olive branch and communicate with CPG and SLG, seek consensus, break the deadlock, and work together for the benefit of Hong Kong and for the success of political reform. Thank you, Mr. President. I oppose the motion.
Dr. Kwok-pan. Mr. President, I've been listening carefully to what the loyalists and the pro-establishment establishments have said, and their distorted arguments. I find it difficult to say this, but I find it rather disgusting. Because, well, if someone is lying and that person said, well, I am lying, that is okay. And if someone says, well, the NPCSC doesn't give you a genuine universal suffrage, it's actually a bogus one, I find that palatable. However, well, for some people, they know full well that it's a fake one, but they keep telling us that it's a genuine one. I find these people rather distasteful. Democracy is not something new. Hong Kong people may not be the wisest of all people. In 1988, we asked for direct election, and Dr. Sun Yat's son made it very clear that he wanted a democratic system. And then later, Chinese Communist Party, including the ex-state leader Mao Zedong, said, if in the future there is no democracy in China, then there is no future for China. He has actually cheated hundreds of thousands of people, because once the CCP has taken power, they remain in power till now. What they promised, what they have written on in the Constitution, say for example, the freedom of expression, freedom of the press, freedom to strike, it exists in name only. Perhaps they're so used to reading the lies in articles, getting so used to lying through their teeth. Compared to the CCP, well, the loyalists here are just telling lies of a very small scale. For people who are so used to lies, who are so jaded by it, and they themselves have started lying, then there is no future for this race or this country. In China, we have efforts to combat corruption, and there are also political struggles. A number of high-ranking officials, say for example Li Jihua, are now arrested. Why? Why are they allowed to become so corrupt in the first place? It's because of the system of the country. If the government has no public mandate, it is not ruling with the right power. As you all know that, in Hong Kong there is an increasing influence from the mainland. There are red capitalists, red capital coming to Hong Kong, influence our decision. But still, over 1 million people participated in the umbrella movement. Leung Chao said that there is more to come. So it's like a threat. What is he trying to do? He tries to threaten Hong Kong people. Well, since you are ill, I may as well kill you. You want universal suffrage. So they now give you two choices. Either a standstill, the same small circle election, that returns CY Leung, Dong Qiwa, and Donald Zhang, or bogus universal suffrage. The merit of a bogus universal suffrage is there is one person, one vote.
is universal suffrage anyway. So if you don't take it, you will never have it. It's like Hong Kong is sick, is waiting for the treatment which is called universal suffrage. But the thing is, the two options offered, they are both poisons. So you either die there and then or you die later. Someone said that it doesn't matter that a country has gone out of its mind or is dreaming. What is worse is that the people refuse to wake up knowing full well that they are dreaming or they have gone crazy. And that is China. Because they pretend they don't see a corrupt government. But now, the same thing is shoved down our throat. We know that if we take it, we'll die. CY Leung was returned by 1,200 people. He is so blasé. He's in a mess. He's taken dubious payment. And nothing is done. And he lied through his teeth here. If we accept this bogus universal suffrage, then maybe a million people will vote for him. Then he'll claim that he has public mandate. And what is coming for certain is Article 23, National Security Law, and the National Education. They're just at our doorstep. They are at our doorstep. With National Security Law, Article 23, then Hong Kong people who are without arms will be subject to threats. But Hong Kong people have backbones. They do not back down, even in the face of an authoritarian government. Just like what Ms. Audrey Yu said, we'd rather stand still than make a mistake. I so submit. Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan.
Lee Cheung-yan.
Mr. Lee Cheung-yan. Mr. President, we take this chance to make it clear why we have to veto this constitutional reform proposal under the framework of the NPCSC August decision, why we can't pocket it first. The basis is very simple. I've heard from the loyalists, their arguments are very clear, are very simple, that the central authorities have power. One country is above two systems. And if we do not pocket it, we are to blame. If you think that one country is above two systems is minor, and Hong Kong should listen to the central authorities, otherwise, bad luck for you. If you believe that, I have nothing to say to you because I won't be able to convince you. But I believe that the majority of Hong Kong people don't think like this. Hong Kong is Hong Kong because a lot of people didn't trust the CCP. They came to Hong Kong. They are senior, and they have felt how important it is to have freedom of how important it is to have freedom. And that's why Hong Kong is successful. And that is the reason why Hong Kong is not just another Chinese city. If you believe what the loyalists said, that one country is above two systems, then yes, we don't need democracy here because people should dance to the tune of the central authorities. Pan-democrats have been asking for one person, one vote. But starting from this year, it's the slogan of the loyalists. And it's all over the banners. Why? Because central authority said, yes, you can say that now. When we use that as our slogan, why did they not say it? Because they haven't been given a go-ahead by the central authorities. And now we ask for genuine universal suffrage. Then they say, we love bogus universal suffrage. We love one person, one vote. That is very simple, but don't force it on us. We're very clear. The first and foremost reason why we object to the NPCSC August decision is because of the rule of law. The decision of the NPCSC is a violation of the three steps process of the basic law and the 2004 NPCSC interpretation. Well, that is already a bad day because the three-step system is a very weak protection of our way towards democracy. And on top of that, there was the NPCSC decision. And on top of that, there is another NPCSC decision. The one in 2004 said that central authority, the NPCSC, is to confirm whether it should be amended. But now they've moved one step further. How to amend it? Please refer to the 2004 NPCSC decision. They have added to it, and now they've added more to it. So what is what is our constitution? The basic law, our constitution itself, is a trick. And now they have added to it as well. And that is the reason why we can't accept the NPCSC August decision, because of the rule of law. And the second reason is that Hong Kong people don't want to say this bogus universal suffrage is a genuine one. We don't want to be the slaves of a eunuch in the Qin dynasty. When he will say black is white. We don't want our candidates to be screened out, to be screened by the central authorities before people can vote on it. Hong Kong people don't want to be a voting machine. If Kwok Kim asked Cyd Ho to apologize for insulting Hong Kong people's wisdom, I ask him to apologize because he actually is the insult. Well, this voting machine is the term first mentioned in 1940s. Bogus universal suffrage will turn Hong Kong people into voting machines. If Hong Kong people believe in the truth, then Hong Kong people will have to protect the genuine package and veto the bogus one. We don't want fake mandate. Well, now we can accuse 689 for having just 689 votes. But in the future, with the bogus package, there will be several 689s, and then people will vote on them. Then 689 votes may become 689,000 votes. And that person can say, now I have public mandate. And we will enact Article 23. And we can even have a national security, as Stanley Ng said. And he can do it because he has public mandate. He's been returned by voters. That's why we can't pocket it. I think the administration is just trying to coax us to accept it. We can't. There is no genuine universal suffrage here. You said it, because the issue of national security. But the national security issue is always there. It will not be there when CCP finally ends its rule and China has genuine democracy. As long as CCP doesn't trust Hong Kong people, they will always say there is the issue of national security. How can we believe that when you say it 5 years down the line, the situations change? Is it because the national security issue is no longer there? Can't be. That's why we cannot pocket it.
Mr. Frederick Fung.
President, this is the year when we have to consider constitutional reform. So it's a year where we can find disputes. It happened in 2005 and also 2012. Mr. Christopher Chung asked us to sit down and talk. Let's have lunch, have breakfast, have dinner. Mr. Wong Kok Heng says because more than 50% of respondents in opinions want to pocket it first, why not the pan-democrats? Let's get to the bottom of these matters. We know that to trigger constitutional reform, we have to look at the five-step process promulgated by the NPCSC. First of all, the CE would have to submit a report to the CPG for change, and the NPCSC would have to agree, and then there should be a two-thirds majority support this council, and then there should be the approval from the NPCSC. There are three stakeholders: the CPG, the CE, and this council. The CE and the CPG have the enjoys the right to make proposals. This council doesn't have the right to make proposals. We can either vote for it or vote against it. If the three stakeholders have to make it a success, the three stakeholders will have to understand the other stakeholders' views, so that the three can agree on something, and then the five-step process can be completed. In this council, as pan-democratics, we play a role in the third step. If the pan-democrats don't even have one-third of the seats in this council, then the pan-democrats will have absolutely no say in the five-step process. We have more than one-third of the seats here, and that's why we have a veto power in the third step. This is because of the design of the system. It's because of the decision of the NPCSC. It's our power, it's our obligation. Therefore, we want to approve a system really wanted by the government, by the people of Hong Kong, in respect of the CE election and the universal suffrage for the system. Why are we criticized by the SAR government? Have you turned a blind eye to what we have done, President? On the 12th of April last year, some pan-democrats went to Shanghai, although we have been criticized for distributing leaflets. That's the first opportunity for pan-democrats to discuss constitutional reform with the CPG officials since 1989. It's a very sensitive moment, and some pan-democrats make certain moves which may be regarded as sensitive. But some pan-democrats remained in Shanghai for the discussion. So it was done. On the 18th of August, through the arrangement of Mrs. Carrie Lam, we went to meet CPG officials in four groups. We were given 1 hour, but we discussed for 1 hour and 45 minutes. Half of the time was spent on national security issues. That was a new experience to us. We got to understand the importance attached to national security by the CPG. Well, prior to that, I had no idea that this issue, this new subject, was so important to them. And this issue would always be there. It would be there for centuries. So how can we go about it? And also we went to Songjiang. 15 of us went at short notice. They represented the 23-member democratic camp. We spent all our time, we exerted every effort to persuade the CPG not to impose too restrictive a framework in the NPCSC decision. So didn't we try to work something out? Didn't we propose something that can be implemented in a feasible manner? But the CPG didn't want to talk. Mr. Wong Kok-heng wants us to take into account public opinion. In the report submitted by Siwa Leung, is public opinion contained in the report? In Mrs. Carrie Lam's report, none of the proposals has been reflected in the NPCSC decision. Why didn't the pro-establishment camp say something about this? We are asked why the 50-odd% of the people want to pocket it first, but 40-odd% don't want to. We are underrepresented here. We should have 30-odd members here to represent those people in the 40-odd%. And Mrs. Carrie Lam said that it can be written down for future refinement. And the following day, Mr. Tam Chi-yuan said, no way, there would be no way to improve the threshold of 50%. So on one day, it was said that the system could be refined. And on the next, it said that something could not be changed. The ball is now in the court of the SAR government and also in the CPG. Mr. Leung-sing, President, here, when we talk about democracy, we should not lose sight of the historical context of Hong Kong. Under the British colonial rule for over 100 years, it was a very centralized political system that we lived under. The British would send governors and the governor would monopolize all executive and legislative powers. So Hong Kong people did not enjoy any democracy. When the Joint Declaration was signed, and that is when it was time for the reunification in 1985, the British colonial administration introduced the first indirect election for the Legislative Council. In 1997, on the day before the reunification, no one ever asked for the election of the governor by one person, one vote. Point of order? I don't think we have a quorum here. Ms. Sun, please pause.
Leung-sing.
Mr. Leung-sing. Thank you, President. Let's look at history. 30 years ago, in the Joint Declaration, the Central People's Government agreed that the CE will be elected or selected through consultation locally, meaning in Hong Kong. And the CPG also set out universal suffrage in the basic law. And the promise of universal suffrage was turned into a clause that can be implemented. And now, less than 20 years after reunification, we can endorse this year the legislation on the electoral system for the CE that would take on board universal suffrage. So there's no doubt that the CPG is sincere about universal suffrage. Members who hold a crucial number of votes, if they vote against the legislative proposal, would veto the constitutional reform package. And Hong Kong people would know very clearly who has killed off universal suffrage in Hong Kong. Universal suffrage means equal and universal suffrage. International IDEA of Sweden says this. We make a distinction between universal suffrage and no universal suffrage. There's no such thing as a genuine universal suffrage or fake universal suffrage. The opposition camp only regard those options which they like as genuine and those they don't as fake. Democracy is to allow the people to make their decision, and that's the rule of majority view should prevail. All opinion surveys, conducted before the occupation movement indicated that most people are in support of pocketing the reform package first. According to a Mingbao survey conducted on the first 11th of January, it says a 65% of the respondents want to pass the package, and they are in favor of introducing one person, one vote. And if the SAR government also promised to make it more democratic in 2020, then as many as 64% would accept the so-called pocketed first option. On the 31st of January, LTHK and the POP of Hong Kong U jointly organized a discussion forum, and the discussion was about whether you support the passage of the constitutional reform package. There are more people in support of the passage of the package than those who don't. And today we have seen a list of the ranking of electoral members. All these show that most people would like to see the introduction of a one person, one vote in the CE election in 2017. If people say they support democracy, then we have to find out whether they are serious about this, they are sincere about this. The truth will be out very soon. As Chinese living in the SAR government of China, we should comply with the basic law. We should also abide by the Chinese constitution. According to the constitution, NPC is the highest authority in the country. NPCSC is the standing committee of the NPC. In accordance with Article 31 of the Constitution of PRC, SARs can be set up, and we will practice the system as prescribed by the Constitution. Hong Kong SAR is an SAR under the CPG. Our powers and functions are conferred upon us by the NPC through the basic law. This council doesn't have the status and power to question the decision made by the NPCSC. On the contrary, when electoral members took the oath of office, they warned that they would uphold the basic law of Hong Kong. If they now do something different, they would have violated the oath. They should be reprimanded by the public. Any attempt to invalidate the decision of the NPCSC is unacceptable, both legally speaking and rationally based. They would break all rules and regulations if their way is allowed to go on.
Dr.
Wai-kwok, Mr. President, the theme of Ms. Cyd Ho's motion is to invalidate the decision of the NPCSC and to reactivate the constitutional reform process. That's only a political statement of position. It's not realistic at all. The CPG, SARG, and the people of Hong Kong all want universal suffrage. In July 2014, the CE submitted a report to the NPCSC. On the 31st of August, the NPCSC made a decision. Starting from 2017, we can have universal suffrage for the CE election, and there should be a clear framework for the elections. That's known as the NPCSC decision. As a result, there was a series of incidents in society. Our society was polarized. On the one side, people want to have consensus and to have universal suffrage for 2017 CE election. They didn't want to mark time. On the other side, they did not accept the NPCSC decision because civic nomination was not accepted. They would like to invalidate the decision. Some of these people started the 79-day Occupy Central movement. That's not helpful at all to political development. Rather, mutual respect and mutual trust had been destroyed, and social order had been seriously undermined. And the pandemocrats started this no-cooperation campaign by delaying a number of livelihood-related issues. Facing this very serious political position, in January, the second round of public consultation started. Unfortunately, the pandemocrats boycotted the consultation. They even said that they would veto the constitutional proposal under the NPCSC decision. This indicates that the opposition is afraid of the mandate obtained by the CE elected by universal suffrage. So they're going to oppose any proposals. The people of Hong Kong are told that the NPCSC had eliminated all opportunities for universal suffrage. And then electors were said to become electoral tools. Now, all these political remarks are not helpful to political development, and so-called international standards are not true. Universal suffrage cannot be defined as genuine or fake. If we can have universal suffrage in 2017 for the CE election, we'll have 5 million electors. That will be a big step forward when compared with the 1,200-member nominating committee, and will be exceeding all international standards. The constitutional status of Hong Kong, in accordance with the basic law and our actual circumstances, should progress gradually and in an orderly manner. The NPCSC is solemn and has constitutional status. This request for invalidation is unrealistic. Any change to the method of the CE election has to go through the five-step process. We must not stop midway or ask for a reactivation. And the time allowed or available to us will not allow that as well. The pandemocrats should listen more to public views. Well, what are the public views? According to Hong Kong News POP, 56% of the interviewees were of the view that the LegCo should endorse the constitutional package. I participated and seminars organized by my sector and certain professional sectors. There were views supporting universal suffrage for the 2017 CA election. Not a few professionals said that in society we're having meaningless disputes or empty slogans. An unrealistic request had been put forth. All these are meaningless. We should focus on exploring feasible room for maneuvering. For example, future CE candidates will have to be nominated by the nominating committee. Should the threshold be lower to 100 votes of the nominating committee? Should there be a cap as well, for example, 200 votes, such that we can involve more candidates? The government should provide more platforms to allow all potential candidates to explain their political ideas. To implement universal suffrage in 2017 for the CA election, all these discussions are essential. BPA and myself are of the view that under the framework of the Basic Law and the NPCSC decision, we should support the constitutional package and work out the specifics for the CE election under universal suffrage. We oppose the original motion and the amendment. We hope that members from all political affiliations will follow people's wish and cast a supporting vote for universal suffrage, such that in 2017 we can have universal suffrage for the CE election. Thank you. Ms. Tari Lee. Mr. President, as early as the start of the Occupy movement, some people thought that they could use the movement to threaten the SARG and the NPCSC to urge for a concession. So they suggested civil nomination, etc. Now, these are not in compliance with the Basic Law. They're not realistic. And after months of Occupy activities, members of the public become more realistic. Recent polls revealed that 50% at least of the respondents were in support of universal suffrage, first for the CE election and then further enhancement. More and more people are in support of such a direction. Still, some members in this council asked for an invalidation of the NPCSC decision. That's regrettable. This is an unrealistic request. It will not assist Hong Kong in fostering democracy. Neither will it be successful. Well, they know that they're doomed to fail. Why is it that they still insist on this moral background by chanting empty slogans that will drive the public into a cul-de-sac, such that they will lose the opportunity for returning a CE by universal suffrage? In fact, in Hong Kong and in the international community, it's well known that originally it's a historic event for China to allow us to have universal suffrage. In the 60-odd years of history of the PRC, this will be the first. So we'll set a good starting precedent. Core values include democracy, of course. But there is also the security concern. The CPG is of the view that external forces would like to overturn the Communist Party. And there are also forces against China. As a result, the CPG does not want an election that's manipulated by external forces. We must not allow a person opposing the CPG to be elected as CE. So those who oppose the CPG cannot be nominated. Our road to democracy is a gradual one. We must have democracy on all sectors of the community, and we should adopt a gradual approach to avoid the chaos in Egypt, Thailand, and Ukraine. to the opposition, they'll not consider the historic meaning of universal suffrage to Hong Kong, as well as China's worry about state security. So they don't have fundamental respect for the CPG. They don't trust the CPG. They scold and scold or even demonize the CPG. Naturally, they won't attain the effect they want. In fact, clever people know that if we want Hong Kong to progress constitutionally, we must understand the worries of the CPG. We must learn how to communicate with the CPG. Otherwise, universal suffrage will stay in the stage of chanting slogans. At the beginning, the opposition posed an uncooperative gesture. Not many pan-democrats tried to lobby the CPG to implement a win-win option. Repeatedly, they thought that they're totally correct and the CPG and the SARG were correct. So again and again, they wasted precious communication opportunities. Before the second round of consultation starts, some pan-democrats said that they would boycott the consultation. There was the Occupy movement. They did not succeed. Now, with this blind and cooperation campaign to paralyze the government and disregarding people's livelihood, can all these unrealistic acts attain democracy for society? Don't cheat yourself. All these activities will only destroy the trust between Hong Kong and the CPG and destroy all room for democracy. Earlier, when Mrs. Elliot Tu celebrated her birthday, she scolded the pan-democrats for destroying democracy. She said that they are not democratic. They adopted an opposition stance against the CPG because they would like the British to continue to rule Hong Kong. Mr. President, the last Sunday was the first demonstration after the Occupy movement. The number of participants was far less than expected. This is true. There's no prospect for that sort of movements. In the short term, it's difficult for the CPG to make a change to its decision. More and more people ask whether we would like to stay put or to have universal suffrage in 2017. Do we really want to cast a vote in the polling station in 2017? Now, pan-democrats, you can veto the constitutional package, but you must not take away the voting rights of the public. Now, when can we restart the five-step process if we are to veto the package? Maybe 5 years or 10 years. Politics is an art of compromise. So if you don't make any concession, it will be the foolish choice. I'll suspend the meeting till 2:30 p.m. tomorrow.